Hi, welcome to two-part series of the crux of time management and personal productivity. Let me share with you some of the tips that I have been practicing over all these years for, you know, my own personal productivity as well as to manage my own time. In this first part of the two-part series, I'm going to share with you my own tips and tactics for, you know, how to manage the time effectively. We are going to explore the topics such as Pareto principle, Eisenhower decision matrix, Finnish concept of Sisu, scheduling, and so on. So let's begin. Let me start with a very famous quote by Seneca, the famous Stoic philosopher. So it is not that we have a short time to live, but that we waste a lot of it. Life is long enough, and a sufficiently generous amount has been given to us for the highest achievement if it were all well invested. So it is. We are not given a short life, but we make it short, and we are not ill supplied, but wasteful of it. Life is long if you know how to use it. This quote is from Seneca's famous book On the Shortness of Life. I have read this book many times. It's one of the best books available. I highly recommend everybody to read that book. So I have written an article in Resonance way back in January 2016, The Crux of Time Management of Students, one of the most popular article I have ever written. Many students have sent me, even now I keep on getting the emails that this article has really helped me a lot. So this article is a little bit older, it's almost 5 years old, and I have learned many new skills from, over the last 5 years too. So I actually expanded it to make this video for you people. So please keep watching. So the background of the time management is that, as you know, the time is money by Benjamin Franklin's famous quote, the one of the founding fathers of the United States. So, but we actually squander much of our time, but, you know, though we are really careful about the money, you know, but we don't really treat the time just like the money, though we know this aphorism we have heard of many times. Well, everybody has got the same minutes, you know, approximately 1,000 minutes a day and a limited number of days on earth. Of course, we are slowly marching towards our ultimate goal, that is the death. So managing time efficiently to get things done is extremely important. That is all the time management is all about. So better time management, of course, leads to better personal productivity. So time management is very important if you really want to increase your personal productivity. So there is a very famous law called Parkinson's law, that is, work expands so as to fill the time available for its completion. So if you are given the same task with longer time, then you simply expand the task. You tend to, you know, work slower pace, and, you know, you tend to squander the time. But if the time is very less, then you tend to maximize it, your productivity. Right, you tend to streamline it. So that is what exactly the Parkinson's law is about. It's a really profound. Perhaps you might have heard another law called Murphy's law. The Murphy's law is like, if things have to go bad, then the things will go bad. You know, that is actually nonsense law. It is not exactly law, but Parkinson's law is really interesting. So the more we work, the less efficient we become. So it's not really about hard working, but we have to actually work smarter. That is what the time management is all about. So there is a principle called Pareto. So, or it's also known as 80-20 rule of the productivity. What is that all about? So as you can see here, this one is effort and this is the result. So 20% of the effort result in 80% of the results, you know. So on the other hand, 80% of the effort will give rise to only 20% of the results. So we have to channel our effort on this 20%, the focused and the effort with the grit to give rise to 80% of the results. So that is what you call the Pareto principle. So how to channel it? So my top 5 tips on time management include: focus on the task. So focus is all about avoiding the distractions. So you have to understand that managing focus and attention is more important than managing the time alone. You know, if you can actually manage your focus and attention, then you really don't have to bother much about managing your time. So focus is extremely important in any task that you do. Another very important tip is that prioritize important task over urgent task. Those, these two things you should really know the difference: urgent and important. So some tasks are really important for the lifelong achievement, whatever your priorities of your life may be. For example, if you want to write a book, You know, so that could be an important task for you, while urgent task is attending a call from your neighbor, for example, or your kid or your spouse. So those are urgent tasks, but many people tend to overemphasize on the urgent task and they tend to overlook the importance of the important task. So that is really the problem. You know, that actually saps a lot of time and energy from our life. So what is important is seldom urgent, and what is urgent is seldom important. The famous quote by Dwight D. Eisenhower, the American, past American president. So see, as this quote says, that important tasks are not really urgent, while urgent tasks are not important. So that's very important that don't pay much attention to the urgent task, you know, but important task is extremely important. Right. I'm not saying the urgent task doesn't require any of your effort. Of course, if your house is under the fire, you have to attend it. Right. So urgent tasks are important, but important tasks are extremely important. You really have to find time to do that important task in your life. So focus your attention where it matters. That is the important task, rather than, simply wasting your time on unnecessary thing like social media feeds or urgent tasks. The task will always come. If you make yourself available for distractions, then you won't find any time to attend the important task in your life. So don't commit to the things that don't matter for a long-term goals. For example, calling for the meeting, if you're getting an email that would you like to be part of our team, which doesn't lead to anywhere. So it's better to decline such offers rather than committing, those kind of things that doesn't add on to your long-term goals. So say no often. So it's not that yes is always good. No, learn to say no in a more polite manner. And also you should know how to delegate the task effectively, especially if you are a team leader. You know, if you have people working with you, then you can delegate some of the tasks to your other team members. And, it's always better if you say no, it's better to say that I don't do that. That's better than I can't do, because I don't do is, you are identifying your individuality with it. Right. Personally, I don't do that. Those kind of things. So that actually you're connecting with your motivation. While I can do means you're actually saying some external force is preventing you from doing that. I cannot do that. So it's always better you identify with your motivation. That is why it's always better to avoid the task by saying I don't do some task. You know, for example, I don't drink alcohol, so I must refuse your invitation to go to the bar this evening. So that way, it's not that I cannot drink alcohol because my spouse asked me not to drink alcohol. So another important tip is to automate the recurring task by creating productive routines or habits. So it's really important. It actually saves a lot of your time. If the same task is coming back again and again, it's better to automate such recurring task by creating the routine. One good example would be the morning routine. So the moment you wake up, and how you are actually doing, so the first maybe 1 hour or 1.5 hours you can completely automate it, and you can actually get things done much quickly and in a much more efficient manner, rather than experimenting with different kinds of thing that actually leads to not so productive habits. So scheduling is really important, and it's much better than simple to-do list. Many people make this mistake. They have a to-do list, but they don't schedule their task. So scheduling is really important. And also weekly review and weekly audit, and carefully plan the week ahead. So every week, on every Sunday morning, I plan the ahead, what is actually coming up, what are the deadlines, and with something called trigger list, I plan it really nicely. So this weekly review or weekly audit, so audit could be financial audit and health audit, emotional audit, so everything matters, right, in that audit. So it is not simply the task audit alone. So you have to actually look, your trigger list has to trigger many things, to be taken care of while doing this weekly audit. So I also use the Google Calendar for scheduling, especially for the deadline. I always feed it in Google Calendar and set reminders so that I don't forget it. And I don't over schedule, so it's really important not to over schedule it, because if you have lots of schedule, then you will feel overwhelmed and you feel bored with your system. So it's always better to put lots of break in between, ample of break in between your schedule. So schedule is only for focused work. And the break is extremely important to rejuvenate yourself, right? And the last trick or the tip is be proactive rather than reactive and learn from the failures. So it's really, really important to be proactive rather than simple reactive, So proactive means prepare for the contingencies and prepare well ahead of time. And also, if you fail, just learn it, why that system failed, and try to overcome whatever the problem that you have faced with that failure. So learning from the failure is really, really important. That is actually the core scientific methodology. If you ask me what science is all about, I can simply say it's learning from failures. That is what the science is. So, well, focus is all about avoiding distractions. So there are so many time suckers which don't aid in your long-term value accretion, the important task in your life. So these are all time suckers. For example, watching TV, social media, shopping, Amazon, complaints and trifles with the friends, rumor mongering, gossips, daydreaming, publishing crap, publications for the sake of getting more publications, patenting nonsense innovations for the sake of adding patents to the CV. All these are time suckers. After death, does any of these things matter or not? So that is what, let death be an eye-opener for your life. So that is what I always think of it. Memento mori is one of my favorite mantra, Think about the death. Then only your life becomes a lot more meaningful. So instead of that, channel more to this. Of course, these are all your own personal take on your life. So according to me, so I channel more on reading, or writing something that add value to people's life. For example, my blog or popular articles. So I tend to make the people aware of the common, for example, the critical thinking, and cognitive biases. All those things are really, really important. And learn something new, or take an online course, MOOC. That is a value addition for your life too. Listen to a podcast, exercise, cycle, swim, sleep well is really important for your health as well as for emotional well-being. Fast 1 week a day. Early dinners and late breakfast. Teach, help your peers. Learn a new language, watch the sky. Learn a musical instrument, start gardening or composting. All these are, really productive habits rather than time-sucking habits which doesn't lead to anywhere. So, calculate how many books can you read if you quit the social media. There is a very interesting calculator called Omni Calculator. You can just Google it and go to that calculator and see it. How many books can you read it? Well, another tip is treat time as money, just like what Ben Franklin said. So calculate hourly salary and see the cost of time wasted in social media in terms of money. That is an eye-opener, really, if you really look at that, how much time you're wasting on the Facebook or Twitter, or Instagram. So you can use extension like Rescue Time. One of my favorite extension, Rescue Time, actually tells you, your habits, how actually where you're spending your energy, and it can calculate the time wasted in the websites and social media. Another extension I love a lot, this is Habit Lab, is from Stanford University's IT department. It acts like an enforcement officer to curtail time-wasting websites. So if you install and if you fine tweak the Habit Lab, it will give you that on the Facebook today you spend 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes. The tickering alarm will come up. You can also completely block the feed of the Facebook. You can only use it as a broadcasting your own stories. So many interesting things you can do with the Habit Lab. So turn off all notification from the phone. In my phone, I don't use any of the notification because once I'm doing a task, I want to focus on that task. For example, creating a YouTube video like this. I did a lot of research on this video, friends. While researching on this, to saving money, the tips and saving, of course, saving time. So I tend to put off all the notifications. So if there is a notification, these are distractions. So I cannot concentrate on my work. So don't check phone or email before noon. That's really, really important. In the morning, if you check your phone or the Facebook or Instagram, and you come across some story which is really, really negative, then it might have an impact on your life. The whole day will be spoiled. You might ruminate on that story that you read, and whatever the bad news that you get. So it's always better to automate your first 1 hour and then you channel your entire energy on doing something productive. Then by the noon time, you check your email. There's nothing like, you know, it is really urgent that you have to check your email every day morning. The first thing you do is checking your mail or Facebook. Come on, that is not the case. Another tip is go for media fasting one day of the week. So truly disconnect from the internet. So I had very interesting experience during my Antarctic voyage of almost 4 months long voyage. You know, many days would go without even checking to the social media or even my internet or connecting with family or relative or friends, you know. So there is no phone also available during the voyage, the cruise time. So that has actually give you a lot of philosophical perspective, the meaning of life, the existentialism, right? So the deep philosophical venturing is possible if you're really disconnected from the internet. And it's always better to go for, I do that one day of the week, I truly disconnect from the internet as well as the media. You know, media also includes the news and you know, the newspaper. Stop reading the news for one day. There's nothing is going to happen to you. You can always catch up later. And this one is a very interesting concept, Sisu. Sisu is a Finnish art of courage and fortitude. So this is you know, the courage and fortitude of the Finnish people is very well known. And this is a book which I read recently, and the summary of this book is that there are a lot of tips on recharging. So the top tips are truly disconnect. That's really important. So disconnect from everything and spend some time in a park or even in your home without doing anything. So if you want, if you get bored, no problem. So that recharging is really, really important for your, you know, for your emotional well-being. Embrace the silence and schedule alone time. That's really important. Alone, without anybody to distract you. And do nothing during the alone time. Just sit. You know, or if you like to meditate, go for the meditation. So getting bored is fine, and even it helps us to refocus. Maybe it's a inherent corrective mechanism of human brain, you know, getting bored. So it might be having a purpose of its own. So getting bored is absolutely fine, and it's better if we can actually schedule the time for getting bored. That is what the Finnish people do through Sisu. And another some other top tips for getting back to nature is that think Loki. So Loki means calm and restrained. You know, the Finnish say it's a sin, you know, Sisu, while the Danish people, the Denmark, they call it as Hygge. So Hygge is again calm, right? So you just think in a calm and restrained, moderate manner, and also think know-how. That is the practical knowledge, the skills required for attempting any problem in your life. So search out and ask for help. Don't be shy asking the help. So even you can ask help from the internet. So first you learn how to do the task in a most optimal way. Then you do that task rather than trying and error, try error. That method might not work. So there are a lot of tasks which have already been optimized, you know. So it's always better to go in a standard protocol rather than haphazard manner. And think preparation. The preparation is really, really important. As I told you, proactive is always better than reactive. So steal time for creative work. So if you really want to do some creative works, like you know, drawing a beautiful picture or writing a novel or writing a non-fiction book with you know, hundreds of pages, you know, so how do you do that? So hours don't appear suddenly, friends. So you have to steal them from the comfort. So you must know that this kind of creative tasks are hardly comfortable. You might feel the comfort once you produce such creative endeavors. You know, the moment you release your book, you will feel immensely happy, just like a pregnant woman feel extremely happy at the time of labor. You know, labor is, of course, painstaking. It's pain, gives you a lot of pain. But the moment the baby is born and looking at the baby, you feel in heaven, isn't it? Just like that, the creative endeavors too. So whatever you were doing before was comfortable, while this is not, this will be really uncomfortable. So mind that. The creative endeavors are not at all comfortable. So if you think that this is going to be really comfortable, just like you know, reading random feeds in a Facebook and scrolling through, endless scrolling, in sitting in the comfort of your home. So it's same way you can write a novel or write a book. No, friends, that is not the case. You should get out of the comfort zone. That is the key of getting things done, and especially to produce something worth the value. You know, so be it being productive or wearing mask. Even wearing mask is not comfortable, but of course it has got advantages. You know, of course it protects you from getting airborne diseases like COVID-19. So, you know, mask wearing is not comfortable. Just realize it. It's not comfortable, but still it is important. You know, so same as creative works too. It's not that comfortable, but you know, it pays you dividends on a long run. And also realize that most of the time we are taking the comfortable option of consuming other people's creative output instead of uncomfortable option of making our own. For example, I made this video for you people, and it took me days of research to tell you. Days of diligent research is what has actually produced what you're seeing it now. So I do that because after end of it, when I release it, when I read your comments, I feel immensely happy. I did something for that adds value to other people's lives. But majority of us, what we do is that we just look at a nice video, you know, for example, a music video. The other people have did it, this work, right? Or read a nice book. The other people have done that work. So we are simply passively consuming other people's work, which is really a comfortable option. But if you really want to add on, then this is not a comfortable option. This is an uncomfortable. So you have to get out of your comfort zone if you really want to create something of value. So mental energy is low in the evenings, especially for me. I understood that after years of trial and error. I know that my mental energy is low in the evening. It might be same for you or might not be same. You will have to find out when exactly is your creative spark in the day. So I sleep early and do most of my creative tasks in early morning, because early morning is really productive for me. So you have to find out exactly when the creative spark inspires you to do a creative task for you. And don't find time for the creative work. Instead, make time. That's really important. So if you ask you to find the time, you know, you can say that, of course, you have hundreds of reasons that you are always busy. I have this task, a deadline is approaching, this and that. At the same time, for example, if your house is in the fire, so won't you make your own time to attend that very urgent task? Of course you can, right? You can squeeze in the time for any of these urgent tasks. Similar way, you have to make time for doing this creative work. Of course, these are uncomfortable way. There is no comfort thing. You have to get out of your comfort zone to do this creative works, friends. So analog clock for the time management is really important. Over the years, I learned the importance of the analog clock. So just looking at the digital clock is no, that is not good. So have an old fashioned analog clock with the second hand on the table. That actually improves your time management skill a lot, believe me. So it actually visualizes the passage of time and visualize the time elapsed. For example, look at this. I always carry a clock like this on my table. So by looking at this one, I know that how much time has been elapsed on a task, you know. And second hand, I can virtually tell you the time is limited. You really have to do the task inside the scheduled time. You know, so all these are really important. And more than that, if you look at the digital watch, if you say like the next task is at 6 o'clock and now the time is 5:49, so then you tend to think, okay, we have 11 more minutes to the 6 o'clock, so let us waste that time, let us check the Facebook for the 11 minutes. So that won't happen if you're using old style analog clock with the second hand. So you can use that 11 minutes elsewhere. So this is a very, very good tip. So Eisenhower decision matrix is extremely important. That is by the Dwight Eisenhower, the former American president. His quote, I already told you, what is important is seldom urgent, while what is urgent is seldom important. So prioritization of the task is the key here. So while deciding which task is more prioritized, more important, while which task is less important, so you'll have to look at this, particular matrix. So it's basically about the urgency and importance. So of course you have to pay more importance to the importance of the task. So, you know, urgent but not important. So the urgent and important task is the most prior, then second prior, then third, and then fourth. So that is how the prioritization is all about. So of course, in your to-do list, you can make this kind of quadrant, and then you can put any task in any of these four quadrants, and then you have to pay more attention to the number one and number two, because number one and number two are important, while number three and number four are urgent, but these are not that important, right? So that's really, really important. And prioritize important over urgent tasks. That is exactly what the Eisenhower decision is all about. Important tasks are really important rather than urgent tasks. And managing priorities is more important than managing time. So time management is not really about managing time, but managing priorities of your task. So which tasks are more prior? Of course, important tasks, right? Not really urgent tasks. So that time management is all about managing the priorities. And now coming to the decision, there are two kinds of decisions, you know. One kind is the common kind is reversible decision. It's like a two-way door. For example, I decide to go to Spain for a vacation. So I can always think of, okay, I can cancel the plan, right? So that is like two-way door, you know, that decision I can change it later stage as well. So that is what you call two-way. While some decisions are irreversible. For example, you go abroad for a study. So after spending 2-3 years on your PhD, now simply decide, okay, let me quit it and come back home. So that you're simply squandering the time, 2-3 years, and then starting from the very first thing. So many of the decisions in our life are actually reversible, but some decisions are irreversible. So we have to identify which decisions are irreversible, and those decisions are automatically important decisions. So we have to actually be extremely cautious while making this irreversible decision. Another example would be applying for for NASA's expedition to Mars. Of course, recently they called for 1 year back. So if you applied for it, it's an irreversible decision, right? There is no coming back. Yes, it's a one-way ticket to Mars, you know. And hard work is not necessarily be productive. That's one of the common misunderstanding with many people here, right? So working hard is really, really important. No, that is not. But smart work is. What is smart work, by the way? Focused work on the important task, not the urgent task, but the important task, focused work. That is exactly what the smart work is all about. Long hours and early mornings are not the key to productivity. Another, many people have this apprehension that the long hours, working for a long hour, working overwork at their workplace is the key to the productivity. It is not really. And early mornings also not. So prioritize persistence over the perseverance. So instead of hard work, you should do incremental, slow and incremental progress, focused work. It's really, really important. So focused incremental work with grit. Grit is really an important quality for, personal productivity. That is fortitude and determination. Remember Sisu, the Finnish concept? It's the same thing as grit. You know, we have to actually do the courage, fortitude and determination. We have to approach the task and any kind of the tasks which are important. So we really have to be focused. By the way, overnight success narrative is too familiar but fake. For example, success story of the founder of Sony, the famous Japanese company. I mean, there are a lot of books that way. They actually give you a twisted story. It's not really a true narrative. You know, most bosses declare that they are earning their status. The reason they are so much rich than the rest of us is that they are more virtuous than the rest of us. They forfeit their holidays. They work too hard. They read a lot. They meditate. They prioritize work over life. But they will not say that majority of them are born rich. For example, the Facebook, the founder, you know, or the Gates family, or the Amazon, the founder of Amazon. They were already born super rich. Unless you dig deeper, you won't know that, because the stories will hardly say this is the case. So, you know, they tend to actually create a false narrative of the overnight success. But friends, overnight success doesn't happen. It's an incremental success. And a lot of things are contributing onto it, especially especially on the random events. So random events are really important, and don't overlook the importance of the random events. And now coming to what is important in your life. So if how to define it, so how to find your passion of your life, you know. So to find it, one of the very important method which I learned is something called ikigai, which is a Japanese concept of meaning, a reason for being. So what is the reason for being? Why are you living on the planet Earth? What is the, you know, what is most important for you? So that passion, to find it, you know, you have to actually look at the four things: what you love, what you're good at, what you get paid for, and what the world needs. For example, I say that my passion is traveling. I love traveling. So do I love traveling? Yes, I love. Are you good at traveling? Of course I'm good at traveling. I love traveling and, you know, looking at the places. Of course I'm good. And what you can be paid for me to travel? Do I get money? No, I have to spend money, right? So that I don't get that traveling is not paid for. And what the world needs? Does the world need me to travel? No, world don't need it. Traveling is not good for the world, you know, because its carbon footprint is way, way high. So traveling, I can say that traveling is a passion, you know. So if you have something, some spirit within you, the reason for your existence is something, you know, which is actually an intersection of all the these four circles, and that is what you call the ikigai. You know, so you have to find that. You have to actually fine tune your importance to the ikigai, the concept of ikigai. So then that actually helps you to prioritize your task and to find or to declare, this task is worth my time. This task is important in my life. So ikigai is an amazing concept. Scheduling the task is, of course, is very, very important, to schedule the task, not merely to-do list. For example, this is my own daily schedule. Scheduling for the time management is like budgeting for the personal finance. So if you ever tried budgeting, of course budgeting works to save a lot of money. So it's exactly the same thing for the time management. Scheduling is extremely important. So it's one of the quote I got through the internet. In this day and age, if you don't plan your day, someone else will. Of course, it's really important, because this time is, you know, the decisions that we take, that we think that we are taking this decision, for example, buying a book or buying something through the Amazon. No, these decisions are already being taken by artificial intelligence and regression algorithms, you know, so that you actually, when you browse it, your browsing history, everything, all this data, the big data, the companies make use of it. You are not at all aware of it, you know. So decisions, that majority that you take it, even how you manage your time, the companies are actually doing that. The Big Brother is doing all this, if you ever read this 1984, the famous book. So it's really important that you take control of your time, you know, rather than entrusting someone else to do that. So feed deadlines in Google Calendar. I always do that. So I don't want to skip my deadlines. And identify most productive time. For me, it is usually mornings. Majority of people, mornings are really better for most productive time, because, you know, we have a limited, you know, the resource of the willpower. So willpower is limited. And as the day goes by, the willpower, we keep on using the willpower. So by the time we reach the evening, our energy levels are quite low, you know. So rather than investing our time on a productive task, it's better to devote on housekeeping chores. So devote this for the creative deep task, you know, the mornings. I suggest everybody to do this one, a morning for deep task, like important task, like writing a paper or making something creative thing, like drawing or, you know, designing a new recipe, whatever it is. So less productive time for housekeeping, organizing, shallow administrative task. But however, motivation beats scheduling. So remember of it, motivation is more important than the scheduling. Don't do creative work unless you're truly motivated. For example, writing a nice book. So just because there is a, you know, to write a book is there in your schedule, doesn't mean that you really have to do it, unless you have that spirit within, you know, the force within to write it. So it's really important to get the motivation. For example, creating YouTube videos like this, or writing an inspiring article or a blog post. You know, I don't actually trust only on the scheduling. I really look at it. Of course, I create an environment as conducive as much as possible for me to write or to create the things. But still, if I'm not really motivated, I quit it. I don't actually force myself to do this task. Just because a task appears in the schedule doesn't mean that you will do it with 100% commitment. And half-hearted efforts to get things done leads to mediocrity, which I don't like at all. I really don't want any of my YouTube videos or blog posts or articles to be mediocre, you know. So half-hearted efforts are not at all good. I really need to invest my quality time with full of commitment and motivation for doing the task. So when you find value, keep working. That's also a very important tip. You know, if you find really a value in doing something, for example, I find value in making this video for you because it will help. I'm sure it will help many people, you know, those who are watching this video and really taking notes of what I'm saying right now. So if I find value, then I keep working no matter I have other schedule in my calendar or not. So that is how that the creative spark, I don't let it die that very soon. That's it for the first part. The next and final part of this two-part series will explore concepts such as task automation, automation of digital life, order of the task, weekly review, journaling, avoidance of procrastination, myth of multitasking, Zeigarnik effect, Pomodoro technique, productivity tips for students and teachers, and so on. If you have any thoughts about the ideas that I shared in this video, you're welcome to comment on this video. I would be happy to reply to your comments. Hope this video has been useful to you. If you like this video, please click thumbs up, share it in relevant groups, and subscribe to my channel.